let us now make, as you would say, the case for case making. As you mentioned in your article, should our faith remain evidence-free, skeptics and sometimes even well-meaning Christians will make statements like, faith is believing in something that cannot be proven and for which there's no evidence. On page 25 of your book, Forensic Faith, you wrote, I've heard a well-meaning believer say something akin to, well, that's nice, but I don't really need any evidence. I just believe Christianity is true. I don't really think you can argue someone into the kingdom anyway. Professor Wallace, are Christian apologists trying to debate people to divinity, or are they here to protect and serve?
Well, think about it for a second. Clearly, it seems to me that God does not need us to do anything. I mean, God has the power to absolutely flip that switch for all of us and give us not only call us to him, but also give us complete knowledge of the gospel just instantly. I mean, that is certainly within the power of God. Isn't it interesting, though, that that's not what he actually does? He actually uses an evangelist. He uses somebody to bring the good news even after he's called. He's flipped the switch, and now we're drawn to him, but we still don't understand anything about him. And then an evangelist comes, or somebody comes who shares the gospel, and now that desire, because God has already flipped the switch, is met with information of some sort that then we make a decision on. Now, that's interesting to me. The only question here is, what is the content of the information we're going to give them? That's really the issue for me. And so I would say, look, this is evangelism. This is just straight evangelism. This has always been straight evangelism. This is how the disciples evangelized in the first century. You won't find a Ray Comfort approach. And Ray's a friend of mine, and I love his work. And I've got a lot of articles on evangelism on Ray Comfort's Living Waters website. But this approach where we say, hey, you know, have you ever sinned? Have you ever stolen anything? Well, then you're a thief. Have you ever lied? Then you're a liar. And we kind of help people see their need for a savior, and then we reveal to them the savior himself. I love that approach, but you won't see that on the pages of the book of Acts. It's a very different approach there. It's an approach that says, hey, God's already called these folks. They just need to know what it is, that who is God and what has God done in history. And so a lot of what I try to say is that, look, this is not about necessarily, when someone says, well, I don't need to make a case. Well, you acted on some information that was given to you. Listen, I've got friends, I've got family that are Mormons. They've acted on some information that was given to them. It's quite possible that you can give errant information that leads you to a place that's either false or is not stable enough to withstand scrutiny. And I think we do our young people a disservice when we don't share why this is true, in addition to the fact that it is true. Now I will say this. Every act of faith means taking a step across your unanswered questions at the end of the evidence trail. That is true for everybody, by the way. That is true if you're an atheist. You cannot answer every question about how the universe began, why it appears to be fine-tuned, why is there life when there could be no life at all? Why does the life that emerges in the universe look like it's designed? Why do we have consciousness and free agency? And why do we sense a set of objective moral truths if there is no source for objective moral truths? And finally, why do we sense that things are evil on a standard, unless there's an objective standard of righteousness that we can measure this by? Look, as an atheist, I couldn't answer any of those questions. And I don't think atheists can answer those questions today. Yet most of us as atheists are willing to take a step across our unanswered questions to stay as an atheist. Well, if you're a Christian, there are going to be some unanswered questions. And I can give you the evidence trail, and it'll go just so far. Now, I do think it goes a lot further and gives you a much shorter step than any other worldview. But there will still be a step across your unanswered questions. And we tell this to jurors all the time. Look, I can't answer all your questions. If you're the kind of person who has to have every question answered before you can render a verdict, we're just going to excuse you right now because we can't put you on a jury, because I've never had a case where I could answer everyone's unanswered questions. So a lot of this for us is being able to help people understand, what do we mean by faith? That step of faith. Is it so blind that you start without any evidence trail at all and you make this huge gargantuan step? Because that can lead you anywhere. Or is there an evidence trail that points you in the right direction, stops short of the truth, stops short of what you might even call your certainty, whatever. And that's very subjective. That's why I don't use those kinds of words. You know, oh, well, can you be certain about this? Well, what do you mean by certain? Well, like, what would it take for you to be certain? Are you certain there's coffee in this cup? you know, there's lots of poisons that, and are you certain that you weren't poisoned? Well, you have, I think I've got more than good enough reason to trust this coffee is not poisoned. But you don't know what does certainty mean? There, lots of people who were poisoned in a cup of coffee did not think it had poison in it, okay? So it's quite reasonable, I mean, quite possible, I should say, not reasonable, that you could have poison. But it's not reasonable, and we act at the point of reasonable, not possible. So I would just say that every worldview involves some step of trust, even though you have less than perfect information. And that's true for us also.